Warning: sodium hydroxide and hydrochloric acid are corrosive. Wear gloves when handling them. Greetings, fellow nerds. In this video, we're going to regenerate depleted deionization resin so it can be used again in reverse osmosis deionization systems. If you're like me, you're using a reverse osmosis deionization system to produce purified water low in minerals for your amateur chemistry experiments. Alternatively, you might be one of those weird people that actually drink water. Anyway, the reverse osmosis deionization system uses a reverse osmosis membrane to reduce the level of minerals in the incoming water and then passes the water through a column of deionization resin to remove any remaining ions. This resin has a limited capacity and will eventually saturate. At that point, it will need to be replaced. Most individuals will simply buy new resin and discard the old resin in the trash. If you don't use deionized water very much, and or have a very efficient reverse osmosis system that produces water very low in minerals, so your resin depletes very slowly, then buying new resin may not be that much of an issue. But if you're like me and you use a lot of deionized water, and have a very old and inefficient system that's not quite up to modern standards, then buying new resin can become prohibitively expensive. Fortunately, the used resin can be regenerated by removing the absorbed minerals and replacing them with the hydroxide or hydronium ions the resin is normally loaded with when new. Before we can do that though, we need to first understand what the resin consists of and how it works. Mixed-bed deionization resin is actually a mixture of two types of highly specialized plastic formed into tiny beads. One type is made using negatively charged functional groups, and this gives the plastic an inherent negative charge. This plastic will absorb and hold positively charged ions. In chemistry, we call this a cationic exchange resin. The other type of plastic is made with positively charged functional groups, and so it will absorb and hold negatively charged ions. We call this an anion exchange resin. When they are first made, the cation exchange resin is loaded with hydronium ions, and the anion exchange resin is loaded with hydroxide ions. When they are used to remove minerals from water, the ions are swapped out, resulting in the minerals being absorbed into the resin and the hydronium and hydroxide ions being released. Now, the interesting part about these reactions is that they are actually reversible equilibrium reactions. This means that we can force them backward by using highly concentrated solutions of hydronium or hydroxide ions. This serves as the basis for our regeneration procedure. So let's get started. I have here some completely depleted mixed bed deionization resin, about 80 milliliters in volume. I've also poured off most of the water. It doesn't need to be dry, but it should not be submerged in water either. Now I'm doing just a small amount because it looks better on camera, but I recommend saving the depleted resin from a few full cartridges and doing the regeneration all at once in bulk to save time and labor. Now as is, this is very hard to regenerate because we have a mixture of two oppositely charged resins. Any regenerant that we add will regenerate one type of resin, but will completely saturate the other. So we're going to need to separate them and regenerate them individually. Fortunately, we can take advantage of the different densities of the two resins and separate them that way. To do so, we need to make a liquid that is of an intermediate density between the two resins, so one resin will sink and the other will float. First, look at the approximate volume of resin you have, and in a separate container, get about twice that amount of water. I have about 80 milliliters, so I'm going to get 170 milliliters of water. I'm going a little over because I want to keep the numbers simple for the next step. Now to the water, we add 3/17 by mass of sodium hydroxide. So for 170 grams of water, we add 30 grams of sodium hydroxide. Stir the sodium hydroxide until dissolved. I'm using sodium hydroxide because it's very easy to make solutions in the density range we need. Now I know that 3/17 is a very weird fraction, but there's a good reason for that. This produces a solution that is 15% sodium hydroxide by mass. At room temperature, this solution has a density of about 1.168 grams per milliliter. This density will separate the two types of resin. Now once the sodium hydroxide solution is fully dissolved, we pour directly into the deionization resin. I'm using indicator resin because it looks good on camera. So the anion exchange resin changes color as the ions are replaced and the resin is regenerated back into its fresh state. This is another reason why I use sodium hydroxide. It's actually a regenerant for anion exchange resin. So we're doing two things at once in this step. Now as you can see, the anion exchange resin is floating upward. Most anion exchange resin used in deionization systems has a density of 1.07 grams per milliliter when in its hydroxide form. Since the solution is 1.168 grams per milliliter, the resin floats being less dense. I used a bit more some hydroxide to create higher density than necessary for resin separation to account for manufacturing differences in the resin and possible extra water the resin contains that might dilute the solution. Anyway, the cation exchange resin has a typical density of 1.2 grams per milliliter when in its unused hydronium form, but since we're using some hydroxide, we're exchanging out all the absorbed minerals and hydronium ions for sodium. The sodium form is even denser at 1.28 grams per milliliter and helps our separation along. Now I recommend agitating the container a little to dislodge any beads of resin trapped in the opposite type of resin. Try and get most out, but don't worry about getting every single possible bead. A bit of cross-contamination, while undesirable, will not ruin the resulting water quality after regeneration. Don't agitate the resin too much or it'll mix again. Once most of the beads are separated, pour off the anion exchange resin into a separate container. I use twice the volume of solution to get good separation between the two resins. But you can use more or less solution to balance ease of separation versus chemical wastage. Just recalculate your proportions so you're always making a 15% solution of some hydroxide by mass, or a 3:17 ratio. Now pouring is actually pretty crude for a separation, and some chemists and aquarium reefers have been successful scooping the resin directly off the top using an ultra-fine mesh sieve or a scoop for better recovery. Others have been successful siphoning out the bottom layer of resin since it actually behaves quite fluidly. Another very popular separation method is to use a separatory funnel. If you're an amateur chemist, then you likely already have one. Otherwise, you can make a crude one out of a sports drink bottle with a push-pull cap. Just cut off the bottom and after thoroughly washing the bottle, you can add the slurry of some hydroxide and resin to the upside down bottle. Then just open the bottom and let the cation exchange resin drain out. Remember to wear gloves since this concentration of some hydroxide solution is somewhat corrosive to human flesh. Anyway, back to my original run. I still have a few beads of anion exchange resin in the cation exchange resin, so to get to it, I'm going to first recover the some hydroxide solution by filtration. And let me get my stir bar. Then we pour the recovered some hydroxide into the cation exchange resin and separate the remaining anion exchange resin. I'm now going to mix that in with the rest of the anion exchange resin and filter off the some hydroxide solution to be discarded. Now we have our fully recovered and regenerated ion exchange resin. But it's not ready for use yet. We need to wash away all remaining traces of some hydroxide. So we use deionized water and continually wash and filter the resin. We have to do this because some hydroxide would get absorbed by the opposing cation exchange resin and deplete its capacity. So we have to thoroughly clean the anion exchange resin now. This is a very slow process, and ideally you keep washing and filtering until the filtrate has a TDS reading of 0 like the deionized water you're washing the resin with. However, as an amateur, this is not strictly necessary and rather wasteful of deionized water. So as long as your filtrate is below the TDS reading of your reverse osmosis water, then your resin is good enough and a tiny loss of capacity will be imperceptible. A lot of aquarium enthusiasts just wash a couple of times with water and don't waste any more time or water than that. Anyway, when the resin is as clean as you need it to be, scoop it out and set aside. And there is our fully regenerated and cleaned anion exchange resin under deionized water ready for use. Now for the cation exchange resin. Because we used some hydroxide to separate the two resins earlier, this resin is now fully loaded with sodium ions and maybe some insoluble metal hydroxides. The anion exchange resin was separated and regenerated in one step, but we need a separate regeneration step for the cation exchange resin. First, we filter off the cation exchange resin and wash it a couple of times with water. We don't need to be completely clean, we just want to get rid of the bulk some hydroxide clinging to it. While that's filtering, in a separate container we get 400 milliliters of deionized water and add to it 100 milliliters of 30% hydrochloric acid. The objective is to get around 5-7% acid concentration. Looking back, I only needed about a fifth as much total solution, but you get the idea. Anyway, to our washed but used cation exchange resin, we mix in our acid solution. This will react with the resin and replace all the other cations with hydronium ions. You can see a slight color change as this happens. I used elute acid to save on acid, but you can use straight concentrated acid if that's more convenient. Now my filter is very slow, so I'm doing the regeneration right on the filter. But if you have a fast filter, then it might be worth it to pour the washed resin into a separate container and add acid there, letting it sit for an hour with occasional stirring every 10 minutes. You need some time for the regeneration to happen and reach completely into the resin beads. Anyway, once all the acid is filtered off, we now have regenerated resin that we need to wash clean just like the anion exchange resin. So once again we're going to add deionized water and filter until the filtrate is clean. Similar to the anion exchange resin, our objective is to reach 0 TDS. But you can stop a bit earlier if you accept the decreased capacity. I would. Once it's reached acceptable cleanliness, scoop it off the filter. And there we have it, fully regenerated cation and anion exchange resins washed and ready for use. Now we just mix them back together to create our mixed bed deionization resin. Be sure to thoroughly mix them so this consistency is uniform. I have too much water here so it's starting to separate a bit due to differences in density. So I recommend pouring off or filtering the mixture and then mixing to prevent this. Anyway, the resin is now ready for use or storage. If you're going to put it into storage, I recommend using an airtight container because the resin will absorb carbon dioxide from the air and be depleted. Personally, I store my regenerated resin in thoroughly cleaned and washed soft drink bottles. So there you have it, how to regenerate used mixed bed deionization resin for reuse into deionization systems. You can stop the video now, but I'm going to answer a few common questions that may come up. First, how many times can resin be regenerated? Resins can last many years through hundreds of cycles. However, it will break down or become fouled as contaminants build up and aren't removed by regeneration. Organic contaminants can dissolve in the resin and react with the functional groups destroying its properties. Indicator dyes may break down sooner though, so you'll gradually lose color distinction between fresh and depleted resin. But the resin should still retain capacity. It's best to keep a logbook or record of how much water the resin processes between changes when the TDS readings become too high. If you notice the resin drastically losing effectiveness, then it's time to discard and buy new resin. Can you use different regenerants than sodium hydroxide or hydrochloric acid? Actually, you can. As long as you provide a high concentration of your desired ions, you can exchange out the undesired ions currently absorbed onto your resin. So for anion exchange, then any strong source of hydroxide ions can be used. Sodium hydroxide is cheapest and popular, but you can also use potassium hydroxide if that's all you have. Hydroxides that have low solubility like calcium hydroxide cannot be used because they cannot produce solutions of high enough hydroxide concentration to effectively regenerate anion exchange resins. So try and stick to potassium or sodium hydroxides. Cation exchange resins require hydrogen or hydronium ions, so you need a strong acid. Hydrochloric acid is most used, but sulfuric acid is also a popular alternative. However, it can precipitate calcium sulfate. Well, this problem can be accommodated by slowly wrapping up the acid concentration in a continuous flow system. This is only really viable in professional systems. Thus, for us amateurs, it's recommended to stick with hydrochloric acid. Next question, can you use a different solution to separate the resin by density? Yes, you can. Highly concentrated sodium chloride or salt solutions can have enough density to separate the resin. This is sometimes done in professional systems as sodium chloride is considerably cheaper than sodium hydroxide. So it's used for separation and after filtering, a much smaller amount of sodium hydroxide can be used for the actual regeneration. For an amateur, the cost savings are minimal compared to labor. But for professionals regenerating metric tons of resin, the cost savings can be considerable. Some professional systems don't even use any special solution and just use water. Carefully agitating the resin will still cause the anion exchange resin to settle on top of the cation exchange resin so it can be scooped or siphoned off. The separation quality is bad, but the deionized water produced from such a system is still good enough for their purposes. So that's how you regenerate deionization resin for water purification. Thanks for watching. And thanks for supporting my videos through Patreon. I'll admit these past couple of months have hit me very hard and I'm still crawling around. But it's your support that keeps me going. Thanks.